All right, so welcome everybody. I am Abhishek Kumar Singh and I am an educator at An Academy. So we've started this new series on YouTube where every Sunday we'll be taking up a contemporary legal topic and discussing it. So I'll be having people from the law background, you know, and Prashant and I have been basically from the same college, and we're both from National Law University, Lucknow. And Prashant and I, and at times we'll also be having more people joining us, and we'll be, like I said, taking up some new contemporary legal topic and discussing it. Okay. Now, the reason we've decided to start this, debating channel is because you see the new patent clad paper, the legal aptitude section of the new patent clad paper basically has two kinds of questions. Okay. If you look at this year's paper, you can see that one, there's a set of questions which is based on the old pattern, which is nothing but a refurbished old pattern, okay, where all the principles have been plucked up together, and there's a big passage on the basis of that you've gotten certain questions. And then there is another set of questions which is based on contemporary legal developments, okay? And for that section, if you look at the sample paper, or for that matter, if you look at the paper that was conducted this year, passages have been lifted directly from leading newspapers like Hindu, Express, Wire, Print, so on and so forth. And you've been asked questions. So what is this new pattern? How exactly is this debate going to help you in that? So in the new pattern legal section, the second set of questions, this is nothing but RC based on, RC with the topic of legal. For example, when you do reading comprehensions, okay, some reading comprehension passages are based on economy, some are based on history, some are based on geography, some are based on science. Well, these set of questions in the legal aptitude section, the new pattern, is nothing but RC, and the subject or the topic for these RCs is law, all right? So you'll be getting passages on contemporary legal development. So at times you can have a passage on, let's say, the collegium system, or, love jihad laws, or the farmer bill, or right to free speech, so on and so forth. And then reading comprehension based questions, for example, what is the author intending to say? What part of the passage denies this? What part of the passage kind of supports this? So on and so forth. So questions like this can come in the examination, all right? So opinion-based questions, kind of opinion-based questions will feature a lot in the new pattern of the legal examination. And which is why we at An Academy, Shant and I at An Academy, decided that we must have more of these robust debates, okay? Because like I said, there will be passages in your paper on contemporary legal topics, and through a debate, you will get to know about a lot of sides and aspects to a particular topic, okay? Which, like I said, in a direct form can be a part of your legal aptitude section. So not just improving your general awareness, not just giving you a flair for debating, but also these debates are going to help you directly in solving those questions on legal aptitude. Okay, so keep watching this space, keep checking this space, where we'll be discussing legal events happening in India and around the world, and discussing each and every aspect of that particular topic. Okay, so the topic that we have taken up today is the new definition of freedom of speech in the modern era. Okay, now this is by far one of the most burning topics in the country today. Okay, now I mean, be it the S, be it celebrities, be it so many cases that are happening around us, there is this constant tug of war kind of a situation. Okay, this constant tug of war kind of situation where there's a section, where there's a particular section of the society that feels that the freedom of speech in the new era is perhaps way too much, that it is actually being misused by people, that it is being, misused by different sections of society. And then there is this one section which feels that we lag behind, okay? Especially if we kind of compare the freedom of speech and the free speech, or the goals of free speech given in India as compared to the Western Hemisphere, okay? So for example, if you take Europe, or if you take US, in comparison, we feel that we still lag behind. So the important question here is that as compared to all these other countries, as compared to countries, especially in the Western Hemisphere, like the US and the UK, or the different countries in Europe, how far behind are we when it comes to freedom of speech? When it comes to the Press Freedom Index, we are lagging down behind. when it comes to different freedoms in the, you know, various lists that are released by all these social organizations. Even there, we are not really performing well. So is this a conspiracy by international media? The first question is. Second is, that is it actually true? Are we not being given the kind of freedom? Some of these events that take place in front of us, some of these journalists being arrested, some of these protesters and social workers being arrested for voicing their opinion against the government, you know, people being arrested for making posts on Twitter and Facebook, you know, at times media persons being arrested for kind of showing something against the running government. Is it symbolic of the fact that, you know, the kind of freedom of speech that has been enshrined under our constitution is being denied to the people in India, or that is not the truth? It's just being kind of exaggerated, and the real situation is that we've come a long way and we are giving the kind of freedom of speech to people that they deserve. So joining me in this debate is Prashant. I just opened the house and Prashant is going to add and basically kind of come up with some new events and incidents to focus on this point, whether this freedom of speech in its ideal version exists in the country or not. So Prashant, why don't you take this up from this point?
Thank you, Abhishek, sir. So my name is Prashant Pandey. I'm a graduate of National Law University, Lucknow, junior to Abhishek, sir. I am also an educator at An Academy. So the discussion for the day, the topic for the discussion, new definition of freedom of speech in modern era, is a relevant topic. It is a burning topic in the contemporary world. Okay, if we consider this particular topic in Indian scenario, okay, so in order to better understand the definition of freedom of speech, we'll have to just trace the bits of history related to freedom of speech in relation to the Indian freedom movement or Indian constitutional development post-independence. Okay, so freedom of speech, what it is, what is the various definitions of freedom of speech, how we can understand the development of freedom of speech, and what is exactly the kind of freedom of speech that we are using in the contemporary India. ठीक है, so उसको हम थोड़ा सा देखने की कोशिश करेंगे. So article 19(1)(a), which talks about right to freedom of speech and expression, is the part of the original constitution which was adopted on the 26th November 1949, finally came into force on 26th January 1950. That particular provision was there because there were certain restrictions. The tranquility and the peace of the country was to be maintained during independence, because as we know, unity and diversity that we understand, that we read today, that wasn't present in the real sense at that particular point of time. When India became integrated in 1947, there were roughly around 576 princely states who were ruling India. So getting all those princely states together without any feeling of enmity between them, that was something that was a challenge to the constitutional makers. So the constitutional makers, they came up with this definition of freedom of speech in 1950 under Article 19(1)(a). Wherein they impose certain restrictions also on the right of freedom of speech. See, the restriction part on any right, any fundamental right, is very essential. Why? Because that is something that sets the limit of that particular right. If you cross that particular limit, you'll be prosecuted by the government, by the state. If you are not able to reach that particular threshold, you are not able to exercise your will, your expression in the best possible manner. So Article 19, Clause 2 of the Constitution, which basically authorizes the government to impose by law definitely certain reasonable restrictions upon freedom of speech and expression in the interest of public order. Okay, so better understand, in order to better understand this particular topic, we will have to understand the definition of public order and the authority which best defines any constitutional provision is the final interpreter of the constitution, the Supreme Court of India. So understand the Supreme Court's public order jurisprudence. It is very important for us to break down the sub clauses into the component parts and focus upon the separate mean, rather than focusing upon the separate meaning. Okay, so the three terms which are very relevant of Article 19, Clause 2, are reasonable restrictions, in interest of and public order. Okay, so in order to understand this, we'll have to just go back in history and categorize this definition of free speech into basically three different phases. The first phase was 1949 to 1950, the time constitution was adopted until it came into force. That was one of the time, okay, which we can also call the pre-first amendment phase, the first constitutional amendment which came in 1951. It made certain changes in Article 19, Clause 2 also. Okay, so we will just categorize it in that manner. So I'm not going into very much detail of the definition of freedom of speech. So this particular phase was the time which was categorized by a highly speech protective approach and a rigorous scrutiny of speech restricting laws. So a lot of newspapers, journals, they were restricted because beforehand they could be published, before the actual article came into being, those were restricted by the government. Okay, the phase two came when the changes in the Article 19 took place and the words like reasonable before the restrictions were imposed, that the restrictions should not be arbitrary in nature, rather it should be reasonable in nature and in the interest of public order is something that is to be understood. Okay, second phase aapka start hota hai, second phase begins from 1950 to 1960, which we can call the post first amendment phase, okay, which is basically categorized by a judicial handoff approach towards legislative and executive action, which were directly aimed at restricting free speech. And the third phase is something that we can call the phase three, which we can definitely call the post first amendment protectionist phase. Okay, it is basically characterized by incremental move back towards a free speech protective rigorous scrutiny by the government. So uska jo judicial approach tha, that was the third part of this particular the phase. Okay, that is it till date. Okay, so after just going through the various definitions of free speech, the basic thing that evolved in the phase from 1960 to till date was basically three important conclusions. Okay, the first important conclusion was that the public order, which explained under Article 19 Clause 2, any violation, any reasonable restrictions should be in the interest of the sovereignty of the state, security of the state, bahut sari cheeze, but ultimately it should not be affecting the public order. And what is the meaning of public order? The term public order as defined under Article 19 Clause 2 is a term which refers to a situation of public tranquility or public peace. Okay, so it is not like a simple rule breaking, that you are breaking a rule or breaking a law. You should be a threat to public tranquility and public peace, then only you can said to have violated public order, and then that should be the restriction should be based upon that, not just speaking or making a statement against the government or any particular important personality, celebrity should be a violative of public order. We have to look at these statements made by general public constitutionally rather politically. The time is high that we understand the implications of these actions of the government, these actions of both the state government and the central government, and we need to ensure that these rights, they prevail. The second important conclusion to the definition of free speech, according to my understanding, is the prior restraint in the interest of public order, which is basically justified under Article 19 Clause 2. Okay, there's a test of proximity which was propounded by Gujarat High Court in a judgment in 2015, which said that prior restraint, it extends to basically all fair space of life. Okay, you'll have the prior restraint is something that is to be handled very delicately by the government, because when we're talking about right to freedom of expression, it is not just a legal right. Freedom of speech is just not just a legal right, it is the inherent fundamental right that is very essential for an individual development. Article 19, we can talk about Article 19 even in times of national emergency, when the national emergency is because of armed rebellion under Article 352. In that particular case also, Article 19 is something that can, the enforcement of that particular article cannot be suspended by even President of India. So in case of even national emergency, because of armed rebellion, if a particular article, the importance of article has been understood by the constitutional framers, will have to understand the implications of that particular article in an individual's life. Because all those rights enshrined, majority of rights under in the part 3 of the Indian Constitution is related to an individual and is very important for his development. And that is why this proximity test, the third important thing is that the proximity test, it should require the relationship, it should establish the relationship between speech and public order to be imminent. Okay, that the speech that you are making should be a threat to a public order, not just a political discussion, but public order. But if your speech is not a threat to a public order, then your restriction under Article 19 Clause 2 should not apply to that particular person. Okay, but that is something that is not happening as of now. Simple instances against the government are being taken as a matter of sedition under the various provisions of IPC Section 124 IPC ke andar mein wo chala jata hai. Or these things are a matter of concern. So we'll have to just understand the crux of Article 19 Clause 1A and then Article 19 Clause 2. Okay, when you will be able to better understand these things, then only these arbitrary actions can be stopped. And for us to understand the complications, the implications of these articles, I think the judiciary will have to step in. Okay, the judicial activism part will have to be very very important in this particular context. What would you like to say on that, sir?
Right, Prashant. So I mean, obviously the law part has been explained very well by Prashant, and he tells us the importance of Article 19 Clause 1 and the freedom of speech and expression. Now, I would like to actually cite certain examples, certain contemporary examples. This is something which is related to the law part, and I'm sure that you know, you already know about the fundamental right enshrined under the Constitution. Let us now see that how exactly things turn out in real life. Okay, and I would especially try to focus on the role of the media. Okay, what kind of freedom is being given to the press? Look, press has been one of the most important mediums of bringing about a social change, and not just in India, around the world. I mean, you talk about the French Revolution, you talk about the Russian Revolution, you talk about the American Revolution. Press or media or the invention of press has definitely been one of the most paramount and imperative, you know, tools in bringing about these revolutions. Even in India, I mean, Prashant, the Vernacular Press Act, the Britishers felt so threatened right after the advent of press, especially in West Bengal. They actually had to bring in acts in order to curb the freedom of the press. The question is that being done again now? I mean, now in the 21st century, the curbs on press, which were needed by erstwhile rulers and dictators, is that in place again now? Because they're actually demanding the kind of social change which is detrimental to ruling governments? Or the story is opposite? I mean, the other side of the story is that press definitely doesn't understand the whole point of reasonable restrictions. And there have been a lot of incidences. I mean, be it the media trial practice. I mean, even before something comes to the court, the press literally in this country already decides if the person is guilty or not. And the press is not the Supreme Court, the press is not the court. But obviously, they're kind of not following this thin line and giving out judgments. So even if we talk about the famous and recent Sushant Singh Rajput controversy, there was a proper smear campaign against this one woman. Later, obviously, she's been acquitted of charges as well. And the court did later acquit her of charges, but then for the one or the couple of months, there was a proper media trial on TV where the screen is split into 10 and everybody is passing out judgments. She was already declared as the culprit. Okay. But then as a retaliative measure, what happened? There is a proper fight. There is a proper lockhead situation between ruling governments and the press. And for this, I would particularly want to, you know, bring into light certain media events. Like, for example, the Republic Channel event where Mr. Ratna Goswami was arrested by the Maharashtra police. Now, without getting into the intricacies of the law, in the sense that There was an old case where a certain person alleged Mr. Goswami of abetting his suicide because of non-payment issues. He committed suicide. The case was closed, but it was later opened. Okay. So without getting into the legalities, because even in the bail application, which was literally fought by honchos, I mean, there was Mr. Harish Salve and Salman Khan's lawyer, I'm not remembering his name right now, who was appearing on behalf of, you know, the government of Maharashtra. I mean, the bail aiding, if you go through the excerpts, then you'll find it on Live Law and Barron Bench and different websites. It wasn't really about the point of law, whether the reopening of the case was justified or not. The application was literally being played on grounds of whether this is government vendetta. Okay, because as we all know, the Republic Channel is vocal in supporting a particular government, and I wouldn't like to directly name it, but then we all know about it. And then there is a government which is not, you know, which is a different government in Maharashtra. So this is government vendetta. Okay. Now, my issue is that finally the bail application was permitted. The case, it was denied by the Bombay High Court, and then it went up to the Supreme Court of India, where it was given. The bail was given. Now, one thing which Mr. Dhananjay D.Y. Chandrachud, Justice Honorable D.Y. Chandrachud, said that this is definitely government vendetta. He kind of indirectly did implicate the Maharashtra government of, you know, vendetta politics and revenge politics, and this action was against Mr. Goswami was unjustified. Then there is something that I also disagree with, in the sense, and this is just criticizing or talk, you know, critically evaluating a judgment, where it was said that if you are not happy or if you do not agree with the content of a particular news channel, okay, then you don't watch it. I mean, you may agree or disagree with the content of a particular news channel, but that does not mean that you can stop them from speaking what they want. Until unless, like Prashant already mentioned, that it in a way kind of interferes with public order. The fact that you dislike what content somebody is coming up with or what somebody is saying does not mean that he's wrong, and doesn't basically gives you the right to curb his freedom of speech and expression. So that is one point of the debate, and I definitely agree with this, and I think Prashant would also agree. Just because I don't like what you are saying doesn't give me the right to stop you from saying what you wish to say. That is definitely justified, and Mr. Chandrachud also said that if the particular government is disliking the fact that they're favoring some other government, okay, you may dislike it, but you can't stop them from saying that, because that's their right. They have all the authority in the country. They live in a country. They can say that. That said, the important question is, aren't we supposed to draw the line somewhere? I say this because, you see, if you look at historical examples, please understand that press has been instrumental in bringing about a social change, in kind of, you know, fueling revolutions to bring about a social change. At the same time, this very press has also been responsible for putting dictators in the helm of action and bringing them to the, you know, and making, helping them become such dictators. For example, if I talk about Nazi Germany, this had played a very instrumental role in making Adolf Hitler who he was. I mean, they were singing glories of Nazi pride. They used to literally promote everything that Hitler was doing. They used to literally say that, you know, he's the best person for the country and everything. It was not being curbed. It was, all of it was not being curbed. So they basically would say something and it was not being curbed. And later, it led to, obviously, dictatorship in Germany. So the point here is that, yes, you can say what you say. That's all right. But then is that saying, in a way, in the future, going to be detrimental for public order? Because right now, if you look at news, there is proper propaganda politics. You know, there are certain channels, I literally haven't come across a news portal which is absolutely neutral in nature. I mean, I don't want to directly pick names and take names, but whatever news channel you see or whatever primetime debate you see, you will see that the direction of the debate is either going in the right direction or the left direction, metaphorically and seriously speaking, left and right. Okay. So now here, the whole point is that a line needs to be drawn or not. I agree that what you say is your freedom. But then if you follow the same thing, then please understand that press is not just a medium to bring about a social change, but bring dictators into, power as well. So if this keeps on continuing, and if the people are influenced in a way that they don't even know the other side of the story, is it going to be detrimental ultimately to public order? Maybe not now, maybe we're not seeing it now. If it's not stopped, maybe 5 years down the line or 10 years down the line. So freedom of press and these unjustified slash justified actions of the state, I mean, how much, is there any water to the debate or not, is something that we definitely need to discuss. So Prashant, would you like to add your 2 cents on this, the freedom of press part? You're muted, Prashant, you're muted.
Okay, sorry. So freedom of press is something that is very important. Press is technically called the fourth pillar of democracy. Okay. So why it is so important and why we are discussing freedom of press in the contemporary time is something to be understood. Okay. I'll take a couple of examples, sir, discussed about Sushant Singh Rajput. And there was also some petitions filed in the Supreme Court of India regarding giving the communal color to some news channels into some incidences related to COVID-19 infections, okay, among those who attended a Tablighi Jamaat event in New Delhi. So these are the statements by Supreme Court of India. The central government basically gave an affidavit there that the media coverage predominantly strikes a balance and it has a neutral perspective, okay. Rather, Supreme Court, which was basically looking to be batting for a greater media regulation, the current cable television network regulations, they have become obsolete. Why? Because we can see the famous case of Sudarshan TV, where Sudarshan TV was specifically talking about a particular community and that particular program was not allowed to be on air. What happened against Sudarshan TV, which brought that kind of program that was completely derogatory in nature on the face of it, prima facie, even the court recognized that program was completely derogatory in nature. A simple no air policy key, that particular program will not be aired. That is all that has been done. I think we'll have to move ahead. We'll have to move towards the compensation part when a particular entity like a news channel, which is to work towards freedom of press, is basically trying to spread fake news or maybe acting towards a something that is a threat to public order, we should look at it in that particular manner. For example, if we see the famous Sushant Singh Rajput case, the kind of media trial that took place in that case is also a threat to criminal justice system. That is something that we'll have to understand. Okay, so such media trials, they just not only impede a fair trial, but they also make the mockery of criminal justice system. Okay, which basically is on the universal principle of innocent until proven guilty. But the media, it already delivers judgments. We can say, I'll see a lot of series of cases. Like in 2015, there was a case of Jasleen Kaur, a woman from Delhi. She posted a photograph of a person which she accused of sexually harassing her. She did not attend court even once. She did not go to court once. Finally, the court has to acquit that particular person. But the media trial had already labeled him as harasser. Okay, that he was harassing that particular girl. We can see examples of n number of cases that happened that basically made the mockery of criminal justice system. The Jessica Lal case, the famous Tehelka case, the Priyadarshini Matu case. Okay, so courts have time and again they have condemned the media for conducting such trials. Basically, like for example, in there was one case is Rajendra Jawaharlal Gandhi. Okay, there was one case with Jawaharlal Gandhi versus state of Maharashtra case where court had observed that a trial by media, a trial by press, electronic media or public agitation is the very antithesis of the rule of law. Okay, rule of law, which was propounded by A.V. Dicey, which talks about equality before law, equal protection of law, and it restricts the arbitrary action of the state. It can well lead to miscarriage of justice. This is something that we'll have to understand. A judge, he is acting as the guardian to protect the very essence of right to free speech and expression. But we'll have to understand we are living in a parliamentary democracy, which is where the majority power is controlled by the executive. So we need necessary executive action on these incidences, because if we will not have those, the merry rights mentioned under Article 19(1) would also become obsolete. And okay, so Abhishek sir, you would like to add on to that?
No, Prashant, I was definitely agreeing with your point, and I'm the only point that I wanted to add here is that the scope of this media trial is actually the expanding scope, or the right in the right way or the wrong way, something that we need to decide. But then it is in a way, yes, hampering criminal justice system. And now, like for instance, these rape cases, okay? Now, one very big reason why rape victims in India don't come forward is because the court action, you know, at times it gets very ugly, where let us say if a woman has been, if a woman is accusing somebody of committing rape, then the defense counsel is going to literally rip apart her character in the court of law. He might question her character. He might question the fact that it was actually consensual. He might actually say and allege things like, you know, you've been in such relationship with a lot of men, so how does this one person turn out to be your rapist? So questions like this. And this is one reason. I mean, since the court actions at times gets a bit ugly, and you can't really blame the defense counsel for that, because at the end of the day, he also has to ensure that his client gets justice and is not behind the bars for something that he didn't do. This is definitely one reason why a lot of these rape victims do not come forward, okay? So, in order to minimize the exposure of this trial, which might turn out to be a bit ugly, and if you look at the Jessica Lal murder case, I mean, there was a film also which starred Rani Mukherjee, you can see how it actually can get ugly, okay? How there are a lot of character assassination statements made inside the court. So, in order to minimize this exposure, and promote, make these girls come forward, there are a lot of provisions which have been legally provided to the victim. Like, for example, in situ proceedings, which are, you know, where the press and media are not allowed to sit, you know, where only the family members, or perhaps only the victim and the defense counsel and the culprit is going to be present. So many of these provisions have been made, you know, in order to make sure that more and more victims come forward. But again, as an antithesis, now we have open debates on rapes, you know, in the media. Where, for instance, I was following the coverage of the Hathras rape case that took place in UP, maybe a couple of months ago. I mean, this whole concept, you see, women are afraid to come forward, you know, because they feel that the court trial is going to get ugly. Well, the media trial is even uglier. I mean, there are two sets of channels which are firstly saying that obviously this girl was brutally raped and murdered and burnt alive and so on and so forth. And then there is, you know, five set of channels who are basically saying that she is to be blamed. She had made a million calls with the rapist and obviously her character needs to be outlined. I mean, that was the entire reason why certain legal provisions were made in place, not allowing press inside court proceedings for these rape trials. If you take that away, and if you actually have an open media trial where there are three sets of channels who are saying that the girl is to be blamed, imagine any girl who goes through something like this would think twice that this should basically come out in the open. Because depending on the state that she's been raped in, depending on certain news channels who would rather support that government or not, the case is going to be decided and discussed in the open country. Everybody is watching, and obviously people do. And the problem is that people are fickle-minded. Okay, I mean, yes. You see the coverage for a couple of days, and they would simply feel bad for the girl. And then I can see, I mean, I come across these family group WhatsApp forwards where there is a different coverage. You know, there's a different coverage for a couple of days, and then everybody starts talking in a different direction. They're like, yes, the girl is to be blamed. She was the one, and these are the kind of debates that she was the one who had on a short skirt shield. Why did the rapist to rape her? So opinions are changing. And like I said, criminal justice system is being obstructed in also in another way, which is that the entire reason why girls were not coming forward was because of these ugly court trials. And now these ugly court trials will not just happen within the four bounds of the court. The entire country will watch them because they're happening on media. So the question is that in the name of freedom of speech, would you be allowed to obstruct criminal justice? In the name of freedom of speech, would you be allowed to basically demotivate these victims in coming forward? It was already a problem. You are only making the problem graver by discussing it on open platform. What would you like to add?
I think, sir, it is high time we understand the need for some strong regulations, in particular when we talk about freedom of press. And the reason for that is pretty simple. The reason is simple. Like, for example, we can take one very important example that I would like to discuss before I conclude. That the example of those nano chips being installed in the 2,000 rupees note.